In 1972, American brass rock soul act Gotham released its singular album, Pass the Butter, and from it, the track Behind the Wall. Kind of billowing reeds out of this rather dark A minor tonality. Sort of ominous, slow bass line.
There's a tree.
Bit of a liquidy wah on the guitar.
That's getting near.
There's a train that's getting near, so I'm picturing kind of a scene at a station, maybe during at kind of a desolate hour with smoke and fog.
It's bringing back the woman that I love so dear.
Bringing back the woman that I love so dear.
It's coming here.
Oh, that just that smoky flute. Oh, and such like the these instruments, like guitar coming in, just dropping like a chord, like a walker, and laying it echo. Just creating atmosphere, really, with...
Been away so long.
Yeah, all that, just echoing, just putting droplets of sound, like a bass line that kind of like moves for a moment, and then just drops a note. And that's it, you know, run out.
A living must be strong to carry on and on.
Let's see, who are we here? Okay, first of all, this was like an early stop for Alfred Peewee Ellis, who would play on dozens of albums during the 1970s in the jazz funk mode. And, some interesting stories behind this, actually. This track is written by Billy Vera, who has a very interesting career. At this point, he was best known as having written a couple of very different songs during the 1960s, including Don't Look Back for the Remains, a Nuggets classic, and taking part in a soul pop duo with Judy Clay. I guess the first interracial male female duo, singing duo. Okay, now this is where it really, it goes from becoming just kind of like a slightly ominous, atmospheric, spooky track to being, there's something about the way he just swells up in this. Let's... Oh, I just love the grit he puts into his voice here as he stretches out those vowels and does that big, like, arch. Oh, those blasts of sax, just emphasizing the big swell up of the track. Okay, and we've got those like those very selective placements of rhythmic accents, and those like once again echoey, just momentary interjections of guitar, and then allowing like the space and the echo to kind of fill up the atmosphere with that saxophone. And now he's really showing, now who is it who is singing here? Really showing his range as a vocalist. Okay, acoustic guitar, it says, and vocals. Schuylar Sky Ford. Yeah, really, he had been and his only credit, according to Discogs, he had been showing kind of his restraint, kind of like an understated ness during the verses, and then he like swells up in that kind of like Cocker-esque grit and growl, and his command of the mic just becomes so like self-evident that he doesn't even really have to hit you over the head with his prowess. It just kind of oozes out of him.
A cold and stormy night.
Oh, the echoes. It just gain even more, like, kind of collide.
When she was taken far away from sight.
Like, kind of glowy, misty, sonic haze.
She said that my love we must not hate.
I don't think we have a happy ending here.
Well, soon
I don't think it's kind of meant to. I think that the music conveys the kind of ominous trajectory.
Prayers be answered, it's no longer fate. Twelve years ago.
The way that he's just and I love that how this part of the song, this chorus, it just kind of like rises from that low note that had characterized the verses. It just, without changing tempo, just intensity. It remains slow throughout it. It's like, we never, like, break into anything, like, urgent or brisk or galloping. It's just, we maintain this really slow, kind of restrained pace, but we go from being, like, rhythmless to just kind of accented, yet at the same basic pace. And more intense during the chorus.
Taking them behind.
That echo, or that ascent, yeah, and it's like during the verses, we don't really even change the key center much. We just kind of, we're getting like these atmospheric, echoey droplets of sound from different instruments, and then finally during the chorus, we just kind of like rise up like three keys, and then, yeah, like up to F, that the landing, basically, and then, and yeah, it just seems so full and so like when we finally arrive there, it's just the moment. It's the moment of arrival, or it's almost like kind of like arrival at sort of desolation in a way, because we don't really this track isn't meant to be like about a happy ending. It's taking us someplace else. It's taking us into the dark. That period when so many like white vocalists, I don't know much. I'm assuming that this band is. This band is kind of, this is integrated, let's say, but the vocalist, he sounds like, it's that period where the influence of, like, the Chicago blues and, like, caterwauling vocalists from the soul scene were influencing, like, white rock vocalists to kind of just go for that raspy, you know, really gritty tone, like let it all. And it was a period like no other in like taking things to that direction. Like later on, subsequent generations would take more of the crooner approach, the smoother. And it's just kind of like a real mark of the time. It's like exploring this type of real full throated singing. And it just has a charm all of its own. In an era, I guess only in an era that had this overall kind of aesthetic attitude of just kind of like let it all hang out, that the kind of embrace of all things kind of greasy and gritty, yeah, could this have been taken to such an extent, and that you would have these rare moments where it could be used in a very refined musical setting like this, and where you'll have like these moments of just, I mean, how many tracks can you think of where that voice just kind of gradually like oozes right out of such a subdued passage, and the contrast it provides against the musical setting, that grit he puts into it there.
Love the countryside, how we waited for the day to come.
A bit of a clipped, kind of like staccato bits here.
When we would hear.
Now that's very kind of un-72-ish. It's almost kind of like ska-like in a way. Dun, na, na. In ska it would be na, 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 na. Now we've got some like creative use of like the hi-hat and cymbal, just once it used as atmospheric devices here.
A woman, she was taken far away from sight.
The woman, she was taken far away from sight.
She said that night. Love it must not hate.
Billy Vera, I guess, has recorded this song himself. I wonder if it was... Yeah, well, the other story about Billy Vera, the reason I'm surprised to see his name on this, not knowing any other versions of the song, is that the 70s were a slow decade for him. I basically know him as a guy that had a bit of success and almost broke through in the 60s and was in that duo that I mentioned. And then suddenly in 1987, out of nowhere, had a big hit with a song that he had originally released in 1981. Yeah, so very unorthodox career. Oh, and I will always remember him for a quote in Rolling Stone magazine. It's really funny, but not to get too sidetracked by that. But yeah, the 70s, or as Wiki says, the 70s were a slow decade for him. I didn't expect to see his name, because he's not a member of this band.
So my prayers be answered, it's no longer faith.
Oh, the way that, just the grit, the growl, yeah. One of those tracks that I think perhaps could have... What's so amazing is that the track is like interesting in its own way. Not so much compelling, it's just sort of atmospheric. And then when it comes to this chorus, and the first time it emerges, it seems to be about 2 minutes into the song or whatever. It's one of those choruses that seems to take a long time to arrive, but when it reaches that whole new level where it suddenly kind of like... kind of just like gets me right here, just that it, because it's got that rising quality, it's got that, it just reaches out at you just enough, and yet it doesn't get more, other than that, it doesn't get more, it just swells up without getting aggressive. Yeah,
I've never seen
I think that his voice is simultaneously conveying rage and yet romantic sorrow simultaneously. a certain kind of solitude. Like it doesn't, like it despite the growling, it doesn't really spill over into anger, because I get a sense that the guy just is kind of like trying to make the best he can with himself in the situation, having really no control beyond himself of what happens. Yeah. Okay, now Peewee Ellis is really, I think this is perhaps his finest moment in the track. And I'm hearing some, let's see, who else are we hearing on reeds and brass? Is it just him? Let's see, Peewee Ellis, oh, and Frank Vicar. Yeah, between the two of them, yeah. The dueling reeds is between the two of them. Oh, and we've also got two brass guys on that. We got John Eckert and John Gatchell, trumpet, flugelhorn. Yeah. And Fender guitar by Link Chamberlin and bass by Chris Qualles. And drums by James Strassburg. Oh, hear that liquid guitar tones on that Fender. Yeah, the brass and the reeds are fuller now, just kind of flanking the track, flanking the atmospheric elements. So Billy Vera recorded this at some point in his career. If I take a look once again at his, let's see, he basically had, I guess he recorded one album, Private Clown, later in the 70s, after having been kind of largely inactive under his own name since like 1968. And then in 1981, he released an album, Billy Vera and the Beaters, yeah, on, I think, a local LA-based label. And let's see, no, I don't see Behind the Wall on that track. He recorded it somewhere, sometime. I have a hard time imagining he would be able to match the intensity of what we just heard. Or the unique, let's just say that what we just heard there is in a class by its own. I can't think of many tracks that have, oh my God, Billy Vera's birthday is just a day off from mine. But 29 years before me. Huh. I found out a while back that he's born on the same day as Lee Sklar. Yeah. Yeah. Anyway, yeah, the track we just heard is in a category by its own, going from those like atmospheric elements and then just kind of like rising up into that really gritty, really just emotionally transcendent passage, just, you know, kind of like a minor rise, really, like three notes, and then never really breaking out and yet not needing to. Having a certain kind of controlled, reserved kind of rage of its own. Yeah. Yeah, that was a Gotham with Behind the Wall from their 1972 singular album, Past the Butter. Yeah. For more Rubies and Sapphires from the Gotham album, see the directory of albums from 1972 linked in the description below for Red Hot Tracks and Purples from over 1,040 albums from that great year. And since Gotham are in the G part, they would be on page 4. Yeah, kind of down page 4. That's where you get to like the G-O part of the alphabet. alongside titles by Gordon Parks, Gordon Lightfoot, Good Thunder, who I just did a few days ago, Good God, who I did a few months ago, Gamora, Golden Earring, Gnidralog, did them about a month ago, yeah. And just right before the Groundhogs, Grobschnitt, Guns and Butter, who I just did, you know, a couple of days ago, Guru Guru, Grover Washington Jr., just to give you an idea of the, and that's just one small cluster of the alphabet, of the A to Z alphabet, to show, and a lot of diversity right there, just to show you what a great, wide open, creative year for music it was around the world, and why it's worth, if you have the time, trying to hear a little bit and trying to hear the greatness of more than 1,000 albums from that era. But don't try and take it all in one day. It can take you years to work through the wonders of 1972. Do it at your leisure. Go page by page. Highlight a red title. Right click, and then open up a tab in the second window, and it should. And the first thing that should pop up, in most cases, is a YouTube video, where you can experience the song for yourself, and yeah, explore 72. You know, whenever you feel like at the directory there. Yeah. Like and subscribe, follow me on social media, share the video, and leave a comment if there are any observations you have about the track we just heard. The intensity, the impassioned delivery of the vocals, the atmospheric elements, the way that instruments were just kind of like dropped, and sounds were like dropped into the proceedings at choice moments, and the vibe that it created, and the lyrics, if you have any observations on those. Yeah, and until next time, this is Zaragon, the world's most air-traveled Tremex most, signing off.